Leah, why consider a reverse mortgage?
Well, in today's economy, many of our boomers are getting a little bit older and they're starting to stop working, actually. And so for many Canadians who don't have an income coming in or who don't have a very strong pension, if you wanted to take some equity out of your home, a reverse mortgage is probably one of the few ways that you can do it. With a reverse mortgage, it allows you to take out equity from your home without actually needing to have a regular income or any kind of money coming in necessarily. It's purely based on the equity in your home. So it's a really good option for a lot of Canadians who are a bit older who may no longer be working.
When you hear stats, recently the Office of the Superintendent of Financial Institutions, OSFI, as they are rather commonly known, suggested that reverse mortgage debt hit $4 billion in 2020. Read between the lines here for us. What does that tell you?
Well, it tells us a few things. It tells us that reverse mortgages are becoming a more popular option. You know, in the past, there was a little bit of stigma around reverse mortgages, but it seems to be becoming a bit more normalized. So people seem to be much more comfortable with the idea. And, you know, obviously, as our population is aging, it makes sense that there's going to be more and more Canadians who are not necessarily working, who do want to access some of the equity in their home, whether be it for a gift for a child and to help them get their first home, or whether be it to buy their own investment property using some of the equity in their existing property.
Tell us about the elements. What's that age? Tell us about some of the other factors.
Well, the sweet spot is age 55. So the homeowners, both homeowners or all homeowners, if there's more than two, need to be over the age of 55 so they can unlock up to 55% of the equity from their home. So that age limit is 55 plus. Typically, the demographic is Canadians who are retired or who, you know, maybe are working very casually, who don't have a lot of income coming in necessarily, other than pension, you know, CPP, OAS, those kinds of things.
And what are the obligations? I mean, there's eventually a repayment. There's a toll, I guess, on the estate. Tell us about some of the obligations here.
Yeah. So in terms of repayment, it's not necessarily repayment on a monthly basis like you would see with a typical mortgage. The way reverse mortgages work is you can either take out the money in a lump sum or you could take out money in increments. So each month, you know, you get an incremental amount of money and that's something you can live on or use for investment purposes or whatever you need to use it for. And then the repayment would happen at time of death, if the people happen to pass away, or at time of sale of the property.
And with respect to affecting the estate and the value of the estate?
So in terms of the value of the estate, the way that things work is if you take out a reverse mortgage on your home, let's just round for common sense here. So if your home is worth $1 million and let's say you take out $400,000 in a reverse mortgage, $600,000 equity is left in the home and $400,000 is the amount that you've borrowed. In 5 or 6 years, let's say you sell the home or you get rid of the home, at that point in time, there's still $600,000 left on the estate. And then the remaining balance, that $400,000 that was owed to the lender, is obviously owed back to the lender with some interest. And past that, the money just goes to the estate, the money that's left over. As we've seen in the Canadian economy or the Canadian marketplace right now, home values are increasing. So any of that incremental gain or incremental earnings on the home, that's the estate's to keep. It's not like that amount is going up proportionally based on how much money the house is worth, kind of thing. It's just the amount of the mortgage that you owe back.
Let's talk about unintended consequences. How does this impact the housing market?
I'm trying to think of how to phrase this in such a way that it doesn't seem, you know, sort of out of proportion here, but I don't think the impact is very, very much. In terms of accessing equity in their properties or their homes, a lot of people are doing that, whether it be via reverse mortgage or whether it be via refinancing, if people are still working. I think a lot of people are understanding the value in using the equity that already exists in your home in order to future benefit your life. So a lot of people are finding that if you take money out of your principal residence and you buy, let's say, an investment property, you can actually supplement your income and pay off those mortgages using that rental property. And what we see with a lot of people who are doing reverse mortgages is actually a very interesting strategy. A lot of people want to stay in their homes even longer. A lot of people are not so interested in going into retirement homes anymore, especially given some of the things that have happened in the last 2 years. And so a lot of people want to stay in their homes. And what they can actually effectively do is they can take out some equity from their home. They can buy a small condo or a rental property that's nearby, that's maybe all on one level. And they rent that property out in the interim. And over the next 5-10 years, they continue renting that property. At the point in their lives when they realize, you know, our detached home is a little too big for us, we don't want to do all these stairs, it's a hassle to maintain. At that point, what the couple can do is they can actually leave their home, move into the condo, and then rent out their principal residence, effectively, you know, maintaining their lifestyle and having the supplemental income of either the condo rental income or potentially the home rental income, helping them to stay afloat along the way. So it's actually a really effective way for people to manage their lifestyle as they move forward and they're no longer generating income.
I didn't hear you use words such as supply or first-time home buyers. What is the effect of this? I don't know if it's a trend or if it's here to stay. What is the effect of reverse mortgages on, I guess, first-time home buyers that are trying to get into the market on a very tight supply as is?
Yeah. So in terms of supply and demand, I think there's a couple of factors to consider. So when we're talking about supply, a lot of people who don't want to leave their homes are going to minimize the supply of those larger homes that people might be trying to move into in order to establish their family or, you know, have more space for somebody who's just starting out. When it comes to the supply, yes, for sure. People staying in their homes longer are going to have an impact on that supply chain. But this being said, it's actually quite a benefit to first-time homebuyers. Let's say, you know, mom and dad or grandma and grandpa are in their house and they want to take out a reverse mortgage. Let's say we know that the kids are planning on getting part of that estate, you know, once the person passes away. At this point in time, what they could do is they could take out a reverse mortgage on the home and they could give the kids that money right up front. So let's say they did that $1 million home and they took out that $400,000 in a reverse mortgage. What they could effectively do is they could give some of that money to the kids, the first-time home buyers who are having trouble getting their down payment saved up. And by giving them that money up front, it's actually helping them to get that step up in life to actually have enough down payment to buy their first home. So while the supply might be diminishing or while the supply might be staying the same, the actuality is that this can really help a younger person buy a home by their parents gifting them some of that equity up front.